coming soon to theaters.
Hi, I'm John Lasseter. I want to tell you about our new movie, Cars. It's a very personal story to me because I grew up in Los Angeles. My father worked for an auto dealership, and I worked there every summer. It was fantastic. And so I've got motor oil running through these veins. I love cars, and I finally put my two passions together, cars and animation.
You're fun. I like you already.
Cars is a computer animated movie where cars are characters. Cars are alive. Cars live and breathe and think. But there are no humans in this world. And it's a rich story where cars have restaurants, but they're gas stations.
How about some organic fuel?
Fat freak juice?
They have shoe stores, but they're tire shops. And in this world, race cars are actually athletes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lightning McQueen!
The story has 1 foot in auto racing.
I'm faster than fast, quicker than quick. I am Lightning.
And 1 foot in old Route 66.
You're in Radiator Springs, the cutest little town in Carburetor County.
And terrific characters. Old cars, new cars, rusty cars, and shiny cars.
I'm a precision instrument with speed and aerodynamics.
You hurt your what?
We found this wonderful, rich world that is so believable and so cool, yet it's inhabited only by cars. If you like metal flake paint with flame jobs, you're gonna love Cars. I'll have more news about our movie Cars when Toy Story 2 Special Edition DVD is released in December. So keep an eye out for it on the road ahead.
Walt Disney Pictures presents a Pixar Animation Studios film. Cars. Coming soon to own on DVD and video.
It is coming!
Golden Globe winner for Best Motion Picture. The rare sequel that lives up to its predecessor. And on December 26th.
Okay, I'm officially freaked out now.
It will be released from the vault.
To infinity and beyond!
Publicity Pictures presents a Pixar Animation Studios film, Toy Story 2, the special edition 2-disc DVD.
What are we gonna do, Buzz?
Use your head.
But I don't want to use my head!
Now you can experience as never before the film that proved there are no small actors, only small parts.
I'm attacking you. Your angry eyes, just in case.
Prepare yourself.
All right, nobody look till I get my cork back in.
For revelations just discovered.
You killed my father.
No, Buzz. I am your father.
And go where no toy has gone before.
I'm a marriage butt.
Ride like the wind, Bullseye.
Toy Story 2, 2-disc special edition DVD.
I'm going to let go of the wall.
What?
He wouldn't.
Three.
He would.
Perfect for that holiday gift card, coming December 26th.
You are the only ladies of the household, I hope, I presume?
There's no one else, Your Grace.
Your Grace, please, wait!
The beauty. The romance. The magic. Disney's most magical fairy tale.
On the stroke of 12,
the spell will be broken.
Digitally restored to its original brilliance.
Talagadoola, Menchikaboola, put them together, and what have you got? Bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
It's like a wonderful dream come true.
Available for the first time in 10 years. Critics say Cinderella is a sheer joy. It's even better than you remember it. Cinderella Special Edition. For the first time ever on Disney DVD, October 4th, 2005.
To infinity and beyond!
Hi, I'm John Lasseter, director of Toy Story. Welcome to this 10th anniversary edition of Toy Story. Wait a minute, has it really been 10 years since Toy Story came out in the theaters?
Yeah.
But I'm still collecting the toys. Toy Story, what can I say? I am really proud of this film. You know, it was the first computer animated feature film ever made. It was the first film we made here at Pixar. But mostly, I'm so proud of the story and the characters and how these characters live on. For this 10th anniversary edition, we have pulled out the stops to make it look and sound better than it ever has before. The picture is direct from the digital source here at Pixar, and it is put on DVD using more bits than ever in the history of mankind. They have loaded it with this chock full of bits, and the sound has been remastered, so it looks and sounds fantastic. We have new special features that it's never been seen before, and it's great. That's all I can say. So I hope you enjoy Toy Story as much as we enjoyed making it. Welcome.
It wasn't just a good animated movie. It was a great movie.
I wasn't prepared for how seamless it was. I wasn't prepared for how deep it was.
And it was an extremely well-received movie because it was worth it. It was a great story.
I think it's storytelling of the highest order married to animation of the highest order.
I think Toy Story became the standard in the industry because it set a whole new precedent for the quality that people expect in an animated movie.
It lifted the bar,
And that's what any good movie should do.
It's fun to look at. It's actually just fun to look at and watch the characters move.
Hey, Buzz! You're flying!
This isn't flying. This is falling with style.
It really was a big deal. Like, there was nothing like this. It was like the first thing. It was like, you know, you equated it to Snow White.
It was weekday in the morning, and the theater was just packed by adults, mainly animators, who wanted to see this movie.
And I remember running from that theater back to Grand Central Station because I had so much energy to burn. I was so excited. I just ran, and my mind was racing.
You just absolutely cared about these characters. You didn't know what they were going to do next. They felt real, like alive. And they collided with each other in real and touching ways, and that the whole movie seemed to be this delightful surprise.
And it also did what must be the most difficult thing for somebody making an animated film. It was able to appeal to both children and adults. I mean, to me, it's a wonderful adult film, and you obviously don't think of Toy Story as being for adults. You think of it being a children's film.
Real artists in any discipline are always excited by good work. There's a kind of what Bob Kurtz calls a joyous jealousy that you see, that you think, I wish I had worked on that. And then you see, well, what can I learn from that?
It just raised the bar, you know? It challenged me, anyway, to just go beyond what I was thinking would be enough to make, to tell a story.
All of us who had seen it in the traditional world just felt like we had to dig deeper in our animation and trying to come out with more honest performances and not just falling back on, you know, animation that the last, you know, traditional animation that had been done for the last 20 years.
It became like the thing you compare yourself to.
And I think it's true. I think it's a wonderful yardstick.
People who looked at that film and said, gee, that's really cool. I'd like to make movies like this.
Something like this comes out and you're like, wow, all right. That's what I want to do.
I'd never heard of Pixar before. Well, who are these people? Who made this? I want to work for them.
I was blown away. It was. I knew what I wanted to do.
It's charming. It's funny. It's full of little ironic twists on your own problems and in real life.
It broke a lot of the conventions of the time. It was not primarily a musical. It was a modern story. It was original characters.
I think that was a very good thing for animation. As someone who watches so much of it, I've gotten tired of having mice sing at me.
Every frame in that film, and I mean that literally, pushes the story forward. There's nothing that is wasted in that film. And I'm talking about from the very first frame.
It was so engaging for me as an adult. I within the first minute, I forgot that I was watching animation.
It's not a kid's movie in the sense that its characters are very adult and they're jealous.
They're like actual people with depth and like there's just like so many layers in them, and you learn about the layers throughout the whole movie.
And when you look inside Toy Story, you see a truth about what it is like to face loyalty, what it's like to be in service, what it's like to be an adult, those toys are adults, trying to cope with extraordinary adversity, all in service of taking care of Andy, this little boy. And there's something so deeply moving about that.
What matters is that we're here for Andy when he needs us. That's what we're made for, right?
And the fact that these commercial items had emotional investment and connections with us was a really canny idea.
Like, my son just left a toy on a plane last week. It blew him away. It killed him. But what about the toy? You know, that's where John and those guys, well, how did he feel? Holy cow. Somebody left me on a 747.
And you, my friend, are responsible for delaying my rendezvous with Star Command.
You are a toy. And I love that. It's like one of my favorite scenes. Because it seems like they're really arguing, and to see like animated characters have that kind of weird, quirky argument like that was just awesome, and it seemed really new.
I was really feeling for poor old Slinky Dog there at the end when he's stretched out so far that trying to hang onto that car. And I'm thinking, do you think there's enough resilience in that spring that he'll ever be as short as he can be again?
I kind of like the kid next door that destroys toys. That's that's something I thought was very amusing.
That's exactly what the toys would do. They'd send somebody down to see what was in the presents. Oh, they'd send the army men. Yeah. Well, now the army men, you know, they're doing a little parody of that guy that, like, you gotta go without me. No, we're gonna take it. No, go on, leave me.
Woody is trapped in the crate, and he's trying to get help from Buzz, who's depressed. And it's all done with eyes, you know, the thinking character. That's what's fascinating about it. The urgency of Woody to get some help from Buzz, and Buzz just so depressed that he's just thinking about his situation. You all see it just through the eyes.
Get over here and see if you can get this toolbox off me.
Buzz is very depressed. And I was going, wow, that's pretty good acting. Wait a minute. If I'm not talking, I'm not in the movie. So one of the most dramatic parts, when they really get dramatic, they're not saying anything. So that's really a drag.
I guess the ultimate indicator of its success is that it became part of the landscape. Sometimes a character has such a well-defined personality that you can refer to him in other contexts, and everyone knows what you're talking about.
All the kids got Buzz for Christmas. All those poor cowboys left on the shelf. We are Woodies in the toy shop of romance.
Oh, you are a sad, strange little man.
To infinity and...
Different franchise, sir.
I give talks in lots of different places in a variety of audiences.
I am Buzz Lightyear.
And it bridges the gap between the entertainment world and what I'm about to do.
Once in the elevator, this kid was crying to his mother, and he said, "I am Buzz Lightyear." And the kid went to kind of a little, "Oh my God!" And he actually said, "I think he thought I ate Buzz Lightyear." Because why is Buzz's voice coming out of that ugly man over there in the towel?
And the mother looked at me and said, "Oh my gosh. Do you know who this is?" And I said, "Hey, kid, I'm Woody. How you doing?" And I grabbed his doll. I grabbed the Woody doll and pulled out a pen and signed, like, the boot or something. Like, signed it. "What's your name, son?" "Oh, Bobby. Howdy, partner. Tom Hanks. Apostrophe Woody." And gave it back to him. This kid looked at me like I just, you know, I just defaced his Picasso for crying. He didn't know who I was. He didn't care. All he knew is some jerk just wrote a bunch of ballpoint pen scribbles all over his prized Woody doll.
Look out!
The fact that it was using computers and it had a complete three-dimensional world allowed the filmmaker to use live-action filmmaking techniques. You're able to put the camera anywhere you like. You're able to move the camera however you like. You're able to shoot coverage of the action just as you would if you were a live action director.
What Pixar is doing is, in effect, honoring the old Walt way of doing things, which is technical innovation that never forgets that it's about characters and story.
I don't think people really cared that much about the technology that was used to make it. It had a nice, sophisticated look to it. It looked, you know, like it had more quality than the 2D animation they'd been seeing in the past. But it was also an extremely good and funny movie.
You know, you don't sit back and think, boy, Pinocchio's well drawn. You're just swept up by Pinocchio.
The negative impact that it's had is thinking that the public is only responding to the technology and thinking that any idea will suddenly become good if it's filtered through a computer.
We made some bad 2D movies, but when we made a great one, it wasn't because it was 2D animation, it wasn't because it was animation, it was because it was a great movie.
I think we can all thank Toy Story for creating the market for 3D animation that we've got right now. I mean, thank God Toy Story was the first one out.
Technologically, we've gone way past Toy Story in CG animation and are improving on it every year. But if you look at Toy Story today, you're still sucked into that world. You still care about those characters. It's still a great movie.
I would argue that if Toy Story has an impact that goes beyond just its own story, is that it says you can be successful when you put your heart into something and tell something with joy and innocence, honesty and purity.
I don't think it matters what country you're in. The film is genuinely universal. It's genuinely timeless.
I think Walt would have loved Toy Story. It's his kind of story.
And it's going to truly entertain and move, generation after generation and generation after moviegoers the same way really, truly a handful of truly great films has.
I was thrilled to rediscover it after 10 years and feel as if I was watching a wonderful movie for the first time. I hope, and I think, people will have that same experience 50 years from now, maybe 100 years from now.
To infinity and beyond!
Calling Buzz Lightyear. Come in, Buzz Lightyear. This is Star Command. Buzz Lightyear, do you read me?
Buzz Lightyear responding. Read you loud and clear.
Buzz Lightyear, planet Earth needs your help.
On the way.
Buzz Lightyear.
The world's greatest superhero. Now the world's greatest toy. Buzz has it all. Locking wrist communicator.
Calling Buzz Lightyear.
Karate chop action.
Wow.
Pulsating laser light.
Total annihilation.
Multi-phrase voice simulator.
In uncharted space.
And best of all, high-pressure space wings!
To infinity and beyond!
Not a flying toy.
Get your Buzz Lightyear action figure and save a galaxy near you!
Buzz Lightyear!
Available at all Al's Toy Bound outlets in the Tri-County area.
What if you found out the sky was falling? Would you tell anyone? Would you be scared? Maybe even a little chicken?
Ow.
forth.
A piece of the sky?
Not again!
The sky is falling!
Something really big is going down.
What's that noise? Sorry, nervous eater.
Walt Disney Pictures presents...
Come on, Dad. We've got a planet to save.
Rock me a little hippie, okay. Bob.
Chicken Little.
Look, Mama, there's the crazy chicken.
Yes, it is crazy little chicken. You're so smart. We don't make eye contact. Bye-bye.
Abby Mallard, a.k.a. Ugly Duckling.
By the way, I'd like to say I've always found you extremely attractive.
Fish Out of Water.
Fish, are you okay? Don't tap the glass. They hate it when you do that.
Grunt of the Litter.
I can't handle the pressure.
Where's your bag? Where's your bag?
Porcupine, porcupine.
Yo.
Butt Cluck.
Son, there's something I want you to know.
What, Dan?
In about 3 seconds, I'm going to scream like a little girl.
Turkey Lurkey.
Hurry!
Oh, look, a penny.
Guys!
Oh, right.
This November. Some heroes are born great. Others have greatness dropped upon them. Disney's Chicken Little.
Well, at least we can sell the video to Chickens Gone Wild.
Coming out of the Disney vault, Tarzan, on a new two-disc special edition DVD. Experience the adventure.
We're saved by a flying wild man in a loincloth.
The fun. One of the world's greatest legends. Trust you. And the adventure continues beyond the movie with never-before-seen bonus features, including deleted scenes, games, and more.
The fun has arrived. Stop it in yourself. Stop it in yourself.
I came home.
The legend comes home. Tarzan Special Edition on a two-disc Disney DVD, coming October 2005.
Master storytellers whose art and creativity are unrivaled. Now, Walt Disney Home Entertainment is proud to bring you the incredible works of two of the most influential filmmakers of all time, Hayao Miyazaki and Isao Takahata, and the fantastic films of Studio Ghibli. From the Academy Award-winning Spirited Away, where you can take a journey beyond imagination. To the enchanting tale of Kiki's Delivery Service. To the epic masterpiece, Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind.
What a mysterious power she has.
To the quirky and irreverent My Neighbors the Yamadas.
Oh, no, turn left.
Right!
No, right, right. No, wait, left!
Make up your mind!
Mia's Miyazaki proves himself to be one of cinema's most gifted storytellers.
Miyazaki's films are fantastic. You should see them all.
And the works of Isao Takahata are one of a kind. And coming in spring 2006, Journey to Amazing New Worlds.
This is a magic house.
This charm will guarantee your safe return.
Find me in the future!
Aboard the incredible Howl's Moving Castle.
Totoro came back, Dad! I saw it!
You must have met one of the spirits of the forest.
And experience the imagination and heart of one of the most beloved of all family films. With My Neighbor Totoro. Also on DVD, look for these other exciting titles from Studio Ghibli. The best in entertainment. Yours to own on DVD.
Hey, Joe, look who's here.
Well, what do you know? It's a butcher.
Oh, this is the night.
For the first time ever, on a two-disc special edition DVD, Walt Disney's original classic, Lady and the Tramp.
What a beautiful little lady.
What a dog.
He's a tramp. But they love him.
Now with picture and sound digitally restored beyond its original brilliance.
It sounds wonderful.
Critics call it one of Disney's most enduring classics.
Open up your eyes to what a dog's life can really be.
Walt Disney proudly presents Lady and the Tramp for the first time ever on a two-disc special edition DVD, February 28th, 2006. The timeless story of a boy and his dog who discover that even in the middle of nowhere, adventure is everywhere.
Get him, Yeller!
Critics say this heartwarming film is still one of the best. And only on DVD, an exclusive retrospective goes behind the scenes and reveals old Yeller like you've never seen him before. Plus, only on this special edition, get a second full-length theatrical film. Old Yeller's legacy continues with the exciting sequel, Savage Sam.
Yeller!
You crazy, wonderful dog.
Don't miss your chance to share this family classic with your loved ones.
I never saw such a dog.
You won't never see another one like him.
Old Yeller, coming soon to special edition two-disc Disney DVD.
Thank you.
The goal of this group has been to do an animated feature from the day I started.
This was the holy grail of computer graphics, to get to the point where you could do the feature film.
It was the first feature any of us had any weighty creative control over. We just never thought about that because that would just get too intimidating.
The biggest thing this film does to advance computer animation, I believe, is it tells a story.
You are a toy!
This film is driven by characters and story first. And even though it is the first ever computer animated film, the technique that we're using is secondary to the story that we want to tell.
I think if there had been another movie done in this technology, you'd still feel like you were seeing the first of this kind of film because of what John does with his characters. It's a very different thing.
I remember the moment when I first saw computer animation of any kind. I was working at Disney as an animator, and two very close friends of mine were working on Tron. And the moment I saw it, it was like, this is it. This is the next step, the next plateau. This is the future. I knew that computer animation wasn't a whole new medium. It was just new tools within the medium of animation. So all the things that I learned as far as principles of animation and film grammar still apply. And so when we started working with it and making short films, the most important thing to every one of my films was story and the characters. That drove everything.
What we wanted to do was every year do another piece and keep advancing the state of our animation tools so that he could do better and better animation. And that's the way we all looked at it. He was part of the development team.
I had all these things that I wanted the system to be able to do. And Tintoy was the very first use of the new animation system and the new rendering system that went on to be RenderMan. Also with Tintoy, I first started developing this notion of a juxtaposition with the audience. It's where you can show them something that they are so familiar with. And then all of a sudden you make them look at it from a different point of view, like looking at a cute little baby from a toy's perspective. From a toy, that's a monster. And we were inspired from Tintoy with the ideas that we had developed in there of toys being alive. So we came up with the idea for the buddy picture with two toys.
In the original idea, Tinny was on a family vacation with his owner, and he gets lost at a rest stop. There, he's found by a junk man who chucks him into the back of his truck. In the back of his truck is this old ventriloquist dummy, and they decide to stick together. But at the end, they finally end up in kind of a toy heaven at a preschool where they'll never get lost or never get outgrown. But then the storyline changed to a kid's room, and the kid gets a new toy for his birthday and is brought into the room with all the old toys. But it didn't make sense that an old-fashioned tin toy, like Tinny was, would become a kid's new favorite toy. So we had to come up with our own action figure. The goal was to make Buzz the toy that any boy would just die to have. We actually went through all of our favorite toys and added everything we could think of.
And everybody had their own coolest toy, but we tried to incorporate as many things as we could into one toy.
We started out with the name Lunar Larry, but then it evolved to Tempest from Morph, and ultimately became Buzz Lightyear.
Woody, the older toy, was based on... Here. Was based on him. This is my Casper from when I was a little boy. This is probably 37 years old. And see, he has a pull string.
Can I stay with you?
See, that's Can I Stay With You. It's like a parent understanding their child's, words. I'm a friendly ghost.
We felt it makes sense that Woody doesn't look immediately like a kid's favorite toy and that he's a little bit more antiquated.
Then that made us think, well, maybe the old toy shouldn't be a ventriloquist dummy with top hat and tails. It was Bud Lucky that said, well, why don't you make him a cowboy? And I thought, that's perfect. You've got the frontier of space. And then the frontier of the West. And so for a while, he was a ventriloquist dummy that was a cowboy.
We did these tests early on of Buzz and Woody, A, to test the models, the puppets themselves. You know, how do they move? Are we going to be able to use this model through a whole feature film? But then B, and more importantly, what is this character all about? How does the inner personality that we've created in the storyboard get expressed through movement? We were just trying to find the character, basically.
We made this test because a lot of people thought that an audience would not sit through 70 minutes of computer animation. People were used to hand-drawn animation, and I knew that when our imagery was lit, textured, and rendered, no one had ever seen anything like this before. It had the feeling like you could reach up there and touch those toys. And that's what we wanted to show the Disney folks and others, what Toy Story was really going to look like. And once we showed it, all the doubts went away.
Hi, pal, what you doing?
I'm Tempest from Mars!
Yeah, what's his butt? Say, you weren't thinking of flying, were you?
Well...
You know, Andy loves toys that can fly.
Really? Well then, to infinity and beyond!
You know, Andy loves toys that he can find.
We knew that this was something that they hadn't done before.
We've never made a buddy movie. We've never made a movie set with these kind of, with this level of contemporary human-type characters.
Typically, a Disney film is fairy tales, retelling of fairy tales.
So what we're doing with John is something we've never had the license to do before.
Here's a chance to put our money where our mouth is and say, okay, you've been complaining about this feature and that feature, and if I were to do an animated feature, here you go, and let's do it. And so we kind of took that attitude and just did what we felt was right, regardless of if it bucked the system.
Turner and Hooch, which was a movie I'd made for Disney, and they actually did have a small piece of computer animation, which was Woody saying the line. It was kind of amazing.
No, you're eating the car! Don't eat the car! Not the car!
Oh, you stupid dog! It fit. You know, if I had come in and seen something that didn't make quite as much sense, I don't know if I'd be doing the movie, but I saw Woody and he talked like I did, so it all made perfect sense.
Tim Allen, as the voice of Buzz Lightyear, he is really appealing. And he can play the macho guy, but with a soft underbelly, you know?
No, go, just go, I'll catch up.
I was actually acting in there a little bit. There's a whole bunch of, you hated it, though.
It's very interesting, because in the beginning, Buzz Lightyear was much more superhero-like, much more Dudley Do-Right. And when we started getting Tim in for the recording sessions, he was putting a spin on it that was... Every animator in his heart is a toy nut. Every animator is a child at heart. I mean, I think you have to be in this medium. And so you walk around Pixar, you walk around Disney for that matter, every desk practically is filled with toys.
I think even if we were making a movie about whales, we would be talking about our toys in the off hours or at lunchtime every day. So we really picked probably the most apropos subject to be making a picture about. I mean, how good you can tell a story is so much about research. And every one of us is an authority on toys.
We focused on each toy and looked at the toy, studied the toy, thought about how it was manufactured with quality of plastic, whether it was a cheap toy, whether it was an expensive toy, all these things, and combined these together to draw the personality out of it, you know? Rex. This is where the personality could come from. There's a few, you know, basic characteristics that we had to have. One, gun barrels always bent. Two, they have the mold flashing, the bits of extra.
Some old sneakers. I got a piece of plywood, and I nailed the shoes down to the board, and we tried walking in this thing and videotaped animators doing this. It was that experience and the analysis that allowed us to convincingly animate the Green Army Men.
While all this is going on, Ralph Eggleston and his amazing staff designed all the sets in the film.
You have so many choices on the computer. It's not the choice, it's what you leave out in a lot of ways. It's not what you put in, because you have a bazillion colors. Do you really want to use every one of them? The thing that a computer does easiest is straight lines, and we have our share of straight lines because this is a film with a lot of architecture. But we tried to soften it by rounding the corners slightly here and there and using a lot of specialized lighting. What we wanted to do was make it believable.
One of the things that makes Toy Story so unique is the collaboration between traditionally trained artists and animators and these amazing computer geniuses. In computer animation, you get nothing for free. Every object you see on the screen has to be created from scratch. You start with blueprints, we call them model packs, and then that's given to a modeler, and they create the model within the computer.
I'm entering some data from the surface of this clay model. We want to accurately capture the shape of it by sampling points on the surface with this digitizer wand. Once we have enough of these points, we can fit a mathematical surface through the points.
We built the system that allowed us to build in essentially facial muscles, to sort of represent muscles in a simple form. I mean, it's not the full complexity of the human body by any means, but still facial muscles that could allow him to lift the side of his mouth, to twinkle his nose, eyebrow movement, all sorts of things that are part of character expression. Then to give that to the animator and give them that level of control.
Our system is designed for these traditionally trained animators with no computer experience whatsoever to sit down within a couple weeks, start animating.
To move Woody, I just move the controls. This is his elbow. I can move his elbow up or down. The next one down is the wrist. Move his wrist however I want him to look. I think if you can actually make it work and read and communicate, without any facial expressions, without the use of your face, then you've done a really successful job. So actually what we tried to do is get everything to read just in the acting, the pantomime, and then when you stick the face on, it'll only plus that.
Buzz, look, an alien!
Where?
The story led, the art direction, the lighting, the music.
We knew that we had a great process, a technique that looked really different and that was unusual, but we knew also that what really was going to, you know, sell the picture was a story.
And we felt that the palette was really limited in animations up to that point of what kind of stories we were getting. And so it was a real conscious effort with Toy Story to just do something different. I remember early on just saying, wouldn't it be funny if we just showed a film where they were stuck in our world, slant that people can relate to, and then to put even more on that, you know, give them sort of...
Worked out the story shot by shot with the writers and the storyboard artists.
We spent about 3 years storyboarding and re-storyboarding the movie over and over again, which is our way of rewriting. You know, we don't stay with the script form for too long. Once we think we got something working, then we want to see it and react to it on the screen. So we draw storyboards like comic book panels. Once we have a scene storyboarded the way we like it, then we go and record the actors.
You do every line probably 17 times until the next time you come back, and then you do it another 17 times. All those 17 ways have to be different, one from the next.
And each time he's giving us choices, you know, each time is slightly different. And in this, you know, we've, much of his lines we've pieced together out of like 3 or 4 different takes.
No! I'm gonna try one of these big ones here at the beginning.
No! No!
No!
Right there. No!
Yeah, I think I'll use that one last little
thing
at the end there.
No!
Yeah, so that's 4, right?
Right.
No!
I'll cut the storyboards together with the voices and then add music and sound effects, and we'll look at it up on the big screen. And then instead of feeling like we're just watching a bunch of still storyboards, it has the feeling of a real movie. Once we're happy with the storyboard and we feel like the story's being told well, we can finally move into the world of the computer. We begin a process called layout, where we essentially figure out which models, which characters we need in the scene, where we're going to put the camera, whether the camera's moving or not. And once we're happy with that, we can then pass the footage off to the animators, and they can do their magic and bring the characters to life finally.
Rockets explode!
When it came time to animate Scud, I really wanted to have that sense of a believable run. And to get that, we looked at the Edward Muybridge book, which gives you all sorts of information on the order of the feet placement on the ground, the push-off with the neck, the arch reversal on the back.
Because even though in our eyes in the movie, Sid's a bad guy and he does bad things to toys, it's somewhat more true to how we were.
We all agreed that Sid was the kind of kid who would grow up to be an animator.
I burned her head the other day with a magnifying
Did
glass.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Tried to burn her lip.
Everything you see on the screen has to be defined in terms of color and texture. Once the textures and colors are chosen, the painter would take those and caricature them slightly. And then they'll work with a technical director to actually apply those paintings onto the object.
The music in ours, we wanted to be slightly different.
You got a friend in me.
Sound took, based on the images having weight and 3 dimensions and a reality to it. Every character in Toy Story had a unique sound signature because most of them were toys we would recognize.
That looks so great.
We were like pioneers, and it was so exciting. Every day you would go to work, and there would be like something new on the monitor, on the screen, and you're like, wow, that's great!
When we were starting Toy Story, we knew that we would probably be making the first computer animated feature film. When it got animated, it was even more exciting. But nothing prepared us for the step that it took after it got. And I mean, I directed the movie. I knew what was coming up. And
just the very beginning of what can be done in this medium. And it's just the first inkling of what can achieve here.
It isn't often one can say, you know, I had a lifelong dream and we fulfilled it. And now in fulfilling that, we can look and say, we've now started something extraordinarily new.
A fantastic group of people, and I had so much fun working with them. And that's what I'm going to remember for the rest of my life.
Has it really been 10 years?
It's been 10 years.
Since what?
Do you realize?
What has? Since what? What are we?
Since Toy Story.
Why are we here?
Now, when did
since Toy Story came out.
Huh?
It's been 10 years.
Huh? Wake up, John. It's been 10 years.
I'm still wearing the same shirt.
I'll never forget you and I looking at each other. You were working on a computer, and I was kneeling next to you.
I remember that so well.
Yeah, so and exactly it sat there, and we look at it, and we looked at each other and went, a buddy picture. A buddy picture, you know? And it was that inspiration of just, you know, of coming up with that idea of you know, having the old toy and a new toy.
And they fell out of a what if they fell out of a van during a fight and they had to get along?
Yeah.
To get back.
And it had never been done in animation.
Right.
Fundamental thing that all of us sat around and said, we don't want. You know,
I remember the fairy tale.
We don't want nine songs that break out in song. We don't want a boring main character.
Little town.
Yeah.
No songs.
No, I want.
No villain.
You know, we want to make the main characters as funny as the comic sidekicks.
Well, there's all this stuff that had become synonymous with animation in the popular culture. Oh, it's animated. That means it must be a musical and it must be a fairy tale and stuff.
For me, that was the biggest motivator through all the hard times was just wanted to prove that theory wrong.
Absolutely. That you can, you know, truly entertain audience, adults as well as kids. Mm-hmm. To me, it was so exciting because at this time, I remember we would all go, and this is what I loved, is that we'd go, hey, we're going to go do a little research. So we all climbed in my car, and we went down to Toys R Us, and I had borrowed, like, a company credit card. We would just go through with baskets and just, like, filling stuff up. But that's where we found that made us... I remember in the aisle, we just started dying laughing. Because the Green Army men, came in a Tupperware bucket,
right.
And it was like...
Bucket
of army men. Yeah, bucket of army men, or U.S. soldiers in a bucket. And we just started howling with laughter.
From the perspective of these guys are all alive and
stuck
thinking
in a bucket.
People.
That was fun to board. It was like, you know, I'd worked at a lot of other studios, and I had fun, but it was like just kicking into that memory of playing with army men.
Well, that's what's neat, is like being in that store, and just looking at every single toy and imagining it being alive.
Yeah. From its perspective.
So much of Andy and Sid came from us, right? And look at this. I will say right now, I was more like Andy, right? I mean, you guys always made fun of me that way. But I always like made
fun of me. Whenever I'm interviewed and asked about this, and they all start giving me a hard time about the Sid character, I always go, that's how real kids play.
Absolutely.
The odd one is Andy. No kid plays like that. Kid puts his face, except for John Lasseter. He's the only guy.
I still have my office full of my toys from when I was a kid. But the thing is hearing the stories show the way you would play with your toys, to me.
My brother and I were really rough on our toys, and we would melt our army man with, like, lighters and just see how they'd melt. And there was one thing, it was a Tonka truck ad with an elephant sitting on top of a Tonka truck, and my brother and I went, wow, really? The Tonka trucks are that strong? And we had a cinder block wall with a loose, huge cinder block brick. And we put the Tonka truck underneath, lined it up, went around the other side of the fence. We were little and went, and heard it came out, and the whole Tonka truck smashed down.
They lied.
And we're like, come on, that's baloney.
Well, then, I knew my son had finally arrived when he got to be about 10, and one morning we were having breakfast together. It was a real quiet morning, and it had been on a stormy day. And as I'm sitting there, you know, I look out the breakfast window, and there on our tree is a half-naked G.I. Joe duct taped to a tree, like flailing like this. And I go, Ben, did you duct tape a G.I. Joe to a tree? And he just went, boot camp. And then he just kind of kept back to eating. I was just like, that's my son.
It's my boy.
And one of the things, I don't know if I'm jumping, is that I find incredibly unique still, even though, you know, I've gotten to the luck of staying at Pixar and working on other films. There was this sort of, I don't even think we could take credit for it, just sort of this chemistry that we fell into, the four of us, when we would be boarding stuff and trying to hash things out.
Yeah.
where we just loved to argue. I think we kind of scared people because we would get so loud and we'd get in each other's faces.
Buzz would never do
that. Yeah, and people would think we hated each other, but the truth is that we were actually hoping we'd be proven wrong. It's like there was such desire to get the answer. Mm-hmm. And it was such an infectious thing. I mean, I just couldn't wait to get back to work the next day and get into that setting.
Well, everybody would sit around a table and we'd all work on the same sequence. I mean, so a lot of these sequences came so fast that I'd be drawing one row and you'd be drawing another row and then I'd clean up somebody else's. You know? Well, the other thing that, looking back, is amazing is none of us had ever worked on a feature film. Well, you had animated, but not in story department. No. Joe is the only one who kind of had been through this before. So we were completely just making it up as we went along.
Why do we have to do it that way?
The more I look back, I think that was an asset.
It was totally an asset.
Because all we would do, I just constantly remember us going, why do we have to do it that way? Or why should you do it that way? Right. It's like we wouldn't do it if it didn't make sense. Or we would make up a method because that made more sense.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Pixar invented stuff, constantly was doing stuff no one else had ever done before. From the beginning, that's all what we've been used to. So we started doing this. I mean, it was just us, too. Like, well, this makes sense, let's do this.
That style of boarding was unique to Pixar, based on, I worked at a lot of other places before. It was totally unique to Toy Story. And we would, you know, group do stuff, and there was definitely a one mind that emerged, or the super friends, or however you want to call it.
The closest
I can relate to our own horn, but it was fun, and we could finish each other's sentences.
It's not so much talent; it's just about whether you can get along. You know.
And also,
arguments.
The arguments.
We don't. That's not the way it went. No.
But I also remember the late nights and how silly we would get. Yeah.
The jokes and the gags we'd pull on each other, or the things that we'd explore just after working together and doing late nights of, like, this is way over the PG line, would be really healthy to just keep the humor going. And then some of it would cross back over the G line and get in the movie.
The thing with the laser tag, remember? The old building. Yeah. Everything was it was like a rental office space. And we would go around, turn off all the lights, leaving.
Because we were working so late, nobody else was around.
Yeah, so everything started. So we'd all run around and have these big battles.
It's so great because you'd get home like at 3 in the morning my wife would go, oh man, we were working so hard.
We played the whole thing. Don't say that. My wife is like, that's all you guys do.
And we were sweating. We were just like.
To me, probably the biggest turning point, for I know the four of us, but I think even for the studio, was as we were developing the story, in the early days, we were just babes in the woods and listening to Disney's notes.
Jumping through hoops.
We'll do whatever. We were so excited to do this.
Yes, sir.
And they know what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. They've been so successful. And we'll just, you know, learn from them as best we can. The notes kept coming back. This is too juvenile. It's toys. It's too juvenile. You got to make it more edgy.
Yeah,
make it more edgy. Make it more edgy.
More zingers.
Come on. More edgy. Yeah. So I remember we had this screening, and we had hired Randy Newman. He came to the screening and everything. He was like, boy, that's a train wreck. You know?
Oh, yeah.
It was like the most horrible screening. And after it was over, no one laughed. And you sat there, and I was so embarrassed for what was up on the screen. And I remember the executives didn't really give us notes then. They just got up and walked out. And right outside, later, Tom Schumacher told me right outside the door, they all turned and said, what happened? And Tom said, they were following notes.
Right.
They were following all the notes we were giving them. And they came to us, and clearly we were right at the stage where we needed to start animating, start production. And they came to us, and they shut the production down. They shut the production down. And they were demanding that our story crew, since we clearly couldn't do it on our own, and this is weeks right before Christmas, move to Los Angeles. And move into their offices so that they can oversee us more clearly.
you know?
And give us more notes.
And because clearly we couldn't do it ourselves.
And we had just hired like 12 animators. We just trained them. They were just up and running. And you can't just grab somebody off the street and start animating on the system. They wanted to fire all of them.
I kind of pleaded with them. I said, give us 2 weeks. Give us 2 weeks. And I think we all looked at each other and said, let's make the movie we want.
But you know, it really gave us, in a weird way, the guts to just do what we had always basically wanted. I remember boarding some sequences early on that did get shot down for being juvenile. And when you talk about them now, they make complete sense with the Toy Story we have now. I remember in that 2 weeks, we just kind of went, we want to go back to that.
And we came up with the notion of that they had a staff meeting, right? The toys are more adult, and so therefore, instead of just having a group discussion, it was like an organized staff meeting, and using the terms that you find in a workplace,
right.
and then making Woody knowing that this is big news and trying to soften
and making Woody
it for
good
everybody.
At his job. That was another Woody thing. I remember you pushing job. That. Make him really good at his job.
Early, we had Buzz aware of his stardom as a TV star. Remember that? Yep. And then we came up with a notion that to make it more clear that he really doesn't realize he's a toy. It's like, here's this guy who lost Woody, who lost his place on the bed to, and it was so great because it was like to a toy who doesn't realize he's a toy. Right. It just drives Woody crazy.
It made it so fun to write for Buzz. Like anything, he would look at a cup and, oh, it's a power module, you know, and you could, it was fun.
Interesting way you drink on this planet.
It's really telling you find those little moments or those little ideas. And
it's
suddenly,
satisfying when they fit.
Suddenly your character's speaking and you're just trying to catch up. That's when you know you don't have it because you're not getting that sometimes with characters.
That's what we turned around. It was kind of the first act. And in 2 weeks, I'll never forget the screening. And, of course, the executives at Disney were really expecting, you know, what could they have done? And they were, like, stunned. And Tom Schumacher, you know, to this day sort of says that he's never seen that in history, that something to be turned around so...
I remember Chris Montan turning around during the middle of it going, what did you guys take, funny pills?
And I was so proud of that. And then that was it. And it was like... We turned the movie back on, and everybody got back working. But you know what? It empowered us. It empowered me to just trust our instincts.
Exactly. It gave you confidence to trust your gut.
Right. And so from that point on, we loved getting notes from Disney, but we used the notes that we thought would make the movie better.
And disregarded all the rest.
We get their notes, we go away, and we'd really think about them and say, and a lot of times you go, no, here's the real problem. And it was even deeper than the notes. Yeah. And here's how we're going to fix it. And then we'd have another meeting where we go, here's the notes and what we think's really wrong or what's not working, and say, how do you agree with that? And they go, yeah. And we think, you know, these notes we really don't agree with. And they go, okay.
Well, that was another thing. And working with Disney was really great to have that distance so we could kind of do what we wanted, but also because the distance gave them a fresh eye.
Yeah,
and they were able to look at things that we were getting really close to, and we'd get a great new perspective.
Every time I have to reminisce and look back, especially having made other movies since then, I pine, you know, for that naivete we had, where the thing that got us through every day was we were just psyched to be making a movie.
Yeah.
It didn't matter anything else. And we didn't, and I pretty much remember feeling up until maybe 6 months before the movie came out that, as far as I was concerned, this was our only shot. We weren't going to make more than that. This was it. Yeah. So, the energy and the drive you get from thinking that this is just your chance to make a movie. I mean, you never took it for granted. You always were aware every day of what a privilege it was to get to make one.
I know, absolutely.
And so I don't remember, for as dark as things got, I don't remember ever being half as depressed as I have on later movies, you know, because I just had that naivete, you know?
And we were having a blast.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I remember most, is just thinking, we're making this for ourselves.
It really was the most selfish movie-making once forever.
We were
this
just,
is what we want
if
to
it
see.
Made us laugh,
yeah. It was it. And it was just like, a fun experience of doing it. You know, the making of it was
what
fun.
What can we get away with?
Right. It's a lot of work, but it was fun.
When it was done, though, and finally seeing it with an audience, still to this day, is probably the greatest reward I've ever had. I mean, it was just staggering.
I think by the time it was about to come out, we knew we had a good movie. I just don't think we had any clue how
well received it was going to be.
Again, I didn't even have any thought the general public was going to see this. It was always just for us. And wow, that was cool. And then when it came out and there was reviews and billboards.
I had some peers call once and they were like, I'm going to see it a sixth time. I'm like, oh my gosh. I just couldn't, you know, but, you know, we were jaded. We had been staring at these images for 3 years, you know, 3.5 years. And for them, it was like they'd never seen anything like it before. Yeah.
I remember so being at a party full of, like, young adults, and I heard people quoting lines from the movie.
Oh, yeah.
And I went, I heard it off in the distance, and I was like, no way.
Well, John, it was the most blissful movie-making time of my career. Hopefully there'll be many more, and let's hope we're talking about another movie 10 years from now.
Yeah, here.
10 years, yay.
Available at all Al's Toy Bun outlets in the Tri-County area.
These are always funny.
So it's been about.
I can't do it.
It's like.
You know, it's been about 10 years.
10 years since what? Gosh, guys, it's been 10 years since Toy Story came out.
Great Caesar's ghost, John. Really?
Yes. Can you believe it? It seems
it's
like just 10 minutes.
Hard to believe.
Boy, what did I tell the fellas about this?
So 10 years. Well, guys, it's been 10 years since Toy Story came out.
Actually, 10 years?
But it's been almost 15 years since we started this.
That's the thing. It doesn't feel like 10 years. It feels like 15.
Longer, yeah.
Because that's about when we start thinking about it.
It's been 10 years since the baby was born.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
Good job.
Yep.
Like it too.
Good job. Yep.
How long has he been gone?
9 minutes.
Come on, guys. Just because Andy's gone to school, that doesn't mean we have to put our lives on hold.
He's eating lunch now.
T minus 52 minutes.
Hey, guys! I think I see the bus!
Let me see. Okay, kids are getting out. Wait, what day is this?
Tuesday!
Blast. Soccer practice.
I think we need a hobby.
Don't you get it? First comes the toy commercial, then that toy is right here in Andy's room.
Oh, look, a commercial for a new dinosaur toy. Hey, it glows in the dark.
Calling Buzz Lightyear! The world's greatest toy just got better! New Cybersonic Buzz! Says over 15,000 word combinations!
A photon grenade! Hit the deck!
Battle Scar Buzz! With ultra damage!
Ooh, that'll leave a mark.
Skyrunner Buzz! It really flies!
Wow!
Buzz is light years better than before! Complete your collection! Today!
There's something to be said for the original.
And that something is yard sale.
Roadblock.
Thank you.
Before I was one of the co-directors of Toy Story 2, I was actually one of the editors of the original Toy Story movie. One of the most difficult decisions that an editor ever has to make, especially on one of our films here at Pixar, is cutting out animation that's already been completed. Because the animation is so expensive and time-consuming, and the animators really just pour their hearts into a lot of this stuff, we really try not to cut any of it out of the film. But unfortunately, occasionally we do need to conceive the scene. We had this whole thing where Sid was torturing Buzz and Woody really pretty violently, and we ultimately decided to just cut into the scene right when Sid is interrogating and to remove all the kind of torturing stuff at the beginning. And the main reason we did that was we realized that our audience was going to be loving Buzz and Woody at this point, and the last thing they really wanted to see was them being completely beaten up and tortured. The other scene that we didn't really cut out of the movie, but we shortened quite a bit, was the scene at night in Sid's bedroom when it's raining and Woody is trapped under the milk crate and trying to get Buzz's attention. The scene was originally much longer than what's in the final film. And at the time that we made the cuts, we made them because we were worried that the scene was playing too long and was just kind of losing the energy of the movie. Now that it's a few years later, looking back, we actually kind of regret that we made a lot of the cuts because we think that it was a really effective emotional scene and it probably could have stood up in the film as is. But you can decide for yourself when you watch the scene.
He's frozen with G-forces now.
Mayday, mayday! He's breaking off! He's breaking off!
Oh, a survivor. Where's the rebel base? Talk!
I'd like to join your posse, boys, but first I'm going to sing a little song.
Liar!
I can see you're with a strong...
Well, we have ways of making you talk.
See if you can get this toolbox off me. What? What are you looking at me like that for? Hey, I didn't do anything. You're the one who wouldn't hide, Buzz. It's your own fault that you're strapped to that thing. I'm sorry, okay? Is that what you want to hear, Buzz? I shouldn't have left you out there for Sid. There, I said it, but you gotta admit, you weren't helping me much. Oh, come on, Buzz, Buzz, I can't do this without you.
In the development of our films, especially Toy Story, we go down a lot of wrong paths.
A lot.
We develop the stories that we think are absolutely perfect. These sequences are just genius. We look at them on the script, great. We storyboard them, they're fantastic. Yeah. We look at them on a story reel, they stink. We're going to show you these abandoned sequences, or more appropriately, our mistakes. And there's a lot of really great ones here that we really love. The Buzz Lightyear cartoon, there's an alternate opening for Toy Story where it's more of a fantasy sequence of Andy's. There's a great Woody's Nightmare, which is actually something that ended up in Toy Story 2. And there's that one sequence that you always talked about that actually, in a weird way, became the theme of Toy Story 2, a little sequence starring Shakes the Rattle.
Yeah, we had this whole character named Shakes the Rattle, who was one of Andy's baby toys, and all the toys kind of gathered around and heard the story about what happened to Shakes the Rattle, because he was abandoned and lost, and lo and behold, that ended up becoming the whole central theme of Toy Story 2.
Yep.
Yeah. So here is a bunch of our mistakes.
I've won! In less than a minute, that planet of orphans will be destroyed. And after you have witnessed my glorious triumph, you will die, Buzz Lightyear!
Not today, Zurg.
He's broken through the indestructible bonds! Bongo, my faithful robot slave, kill Buzz Lightyear! Bongo, fire atomic bases! Bongo! Buzz Lightyear!
Exciting episode of Buzz Lightyear, Defender of the Universe.
Wow, Buzz Lightyear! What a cool show!
You must die, Buzz Lightyear.
Not today, Zurg!
Buzz Lightyear to the rescue! Buzz Lightyear to the rescue! Buzz Lightyear to the rescue!
Whoa, look, Woody! Buzz glows in the dark! Isn't he cool?
Do you glow in the dark, Woody?
Hey, yeah. Let's see if Woody glows. Hey, Woody, you don't glow. I don't think I like you anymore.
Hi-ya! Oh, Woody, you shouldn't sneak up on a superhero like that, cowboy. You could get hurt. Now, that's a safety tip. Now, go back to sleep.
No. Buzz. There's a problem.
A problem?
Yes.
The sun!
No, not...
The sun has been kidnapped! Children can't play! You'll never get up in the morning! No more breakfast!
Oh, Buzz!
The sun is gone!
Buzz, the sun being gone is not the problem. Buzz, it's nighttime!
I see.
Look, the problem is this.
You know, Woody, I think I've been accepted into your culture.
Great.
Your chief, Andy, inscribed his name on me.
What?
Juvenile, but endearing.
And that's the problem!
My foot.
No! No, Buzz. Andy. Andy is in grave danger. That's why I'm so glad that you are here. Really. Truly, Buzz. If you were here, I can't... How can I... Oh, Buzz. Oh, Buzz, my friend.
Get a hold of yourself, cowboy.
Oh, Buzz, I'm not a cowboy. I'm just dressed like one. You see, it's my cover. I was sent here to help you on your mission.
My mission?
Yes. And I know also that we are the only thing standing between Andy and certain... Well, I...
What?
You
what?
Don't,
what?
No,
what?
I can't...
What can we do?
All right. Follow me.
This is your station, Buzz. We call it the Eastern Gate. It's the weak point of our defensive network. Your job is to not let those villainous scum get through to Andy.
Andy! He's been left unguarded!
No, it hasn't! He's fine! Buzz, come back! Buzz, come back! Heal, Buzz, heal!
Don't worry, Andy. No one gets by Buzz Lightyear.
It's Sid.
What's a Sid?
Carl! Run, Carl!
Hit the dirt!
That is a Sid!
Give her back, Sid.
Scott, over here!
Give her back, Sid, please!
Here!
Phillips is just downright evil.
I'm going to have to teach that young man a lesson.
Absolutely, Buzz. Why don't you melt him with your scary laser?
Keep away! You keep away from Sid Phillips. You all are too young to remember Shakes.
Shakes?
The rattle?
The best damn rattle I ever waked with. Till Sid got a hold of him. I took old Shakes into that room of his, and I never seen him again. but I heard. I heard the screams.
You mean like happy screams, right?
Some say pulled shakes apart, like the wings off a fly. There's others that think he melted him in acid, a bit at a time. Pulled his eyes out first to let him watch. But I say Shakes was lucky. In Sid's room, there's things much worse than death. Aye, Shakes was lucky.
Ooh, scary.
Woody, hang on, Buzz. I'm coming. Woody, look out. Sid is in the...
Houston! All systems are go. Do we have permission to launch?
Roger. We are confirmed. At T-minus 10 seconds and counting. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Ignition. Huh?
Geppetto, look! I'm a real boy!
Matches? What are you, 7, 8?
You shouldn't be playing with these. I think it's time we had a talk.
But you're probably thinking,
but
toys can't move!
And we don't usually move in front of people. In fact, it's never been done.
But you are such a...
Vicious.
Yeah, vicious. And stupid.
Selfish.
Nasty,
repulsive little butt face.
That we made an exception just for you.
Please don't hurt me.
Hurt you?
Please don't.
We don't want to hurt you.
I do.
Now, Buzz. All we want is to clear up a few things. Guys. We're tired of being kicked around. We're tired of being blown up, pulled apart, burned, and broken. So we're going to be watching. Yes, sir. All the time. You can't get away from us, kiddo. Your toys can see everything. So play nice.
The toys! The toys are alive! Help me! Help me! They're alive!
They don't like me!
Help! Help! The toys are alive!
I'm kind of new at this toy thing, but something tells me we aren't supposed to do that.
Oh, what harm could it have done, Buzz? Just screwed him up for the rest of his life, that's all.
No, no, no! Ah! Ah! No! I'm sorry! I'm sorry! Oh, no! I'll never hurt you again! No! No! Mom!
It was never a computer movie in our sense. It was never a computer movie. It was in the way, we're making a film. And it happened to be that we had the coolest pencils in the world because we had these great computers and we could construct these things that no one else had the opportunity to construct.
Don't forget this. The computer animation at the time was flying metal things with the camera. Just because you could do anything with the computer, people did everything with the computer.
They first started
You know, talking about computer animation, all I saw was this wireframe stuff, and I wasn't too impressed.
At that time, I couldn't have cared less about computers. I just liked drawing.
Our director, John Lasseter, really had a good vision going into this whole thing about what he wanted. There was the math.
For most people, you were kind of keying off of just something about your own childhood that it just like the sound of it, the kind of basic feel of it was like you remembered when you were a kid on a Saturday morning or something.
In a way, the look of the whole movie is very sort of toy-like, even though it's very grounded in reality, it's very believable.
Everything in animation takes many, many drawings.
Nothing's for free. We have to design everything. We had to be architects, interior designers, furniture designers, industrial designers, costume designers, hairstylists, and of course, toy designers. And it's a huge job. I'm amazed we did it.
Star Command, come in. Do you read me?
Why don't they answer?
We all know toys, and it's something you kind of are familiar with, but you don't even maybe recognize it. So when we built Buzz, we want to make sure he was put together like a regular toy with the little Phillips screw heads in there and all the little details, so it felt really believable.
And there seems to be no sign of intelligent life anywhere.
Hello?
When he started out as a ventriloquist dummy, he started out as sort of a sarcastic, comedic character, which to some degree stayed. Bud Lucky basically had the core concept of making Woody a cowboy.
I just thought a cowboy would be more interesting working with a spaceman.
That sort of sent shockwaves through the whole movie, because that just made the contrast so vivid and so powerful. Woody's a little bit just naturally going to clash. It's almost like the older detective and the young.
Originally, Andy and the toys went to Pizza Hut, a miniature golf pizza place. But when Buzz became a spaceman and wanted to get home, it was perfect. This rocket ship spaceport. We thought everything. We thought the guards at the door, these robots, the crane game with the aliens, and it became this really cool spaceship. The themes of the style and the look of the different video games change. Even the little rocket were much smaller than any human would.
A lot of what I was doing was like I'd go home and I'd be kind of like touching them, holding and looking at everything. Oh, that's what it's doing. Because you never think about those parts of the details. But from a toy's perspective, you had to get down next to all this stuff and have it make some kind of a sense.
It's very easy in the computer to create something that's perfect. What they really wanted from me was to beat up this world. And so when I got my first business card from Pixar, it said Tia Cratter Imperfect.
Ball hits in it. You know, you got the waffle iron. He's a torturer. He's a torturer, you know?
I grew up, I was more like Sid. I had a glue gun, duct tape, my dad's tool bench, and we cut everything up.
I think a lot of stuff was generated for the mutant toys because it was just fun. Like, oh God, I got an idea for a toy.
It was hard for me, at least sometimes, not to make them too cute. Because they got really cute.
After working on it, you realize, God, villains, first of all, are more interesting often than the straight guys. You know, they're just, they have more going on, more you can explain or show about them. And then you realize
this world, which we all believed in and we've lived in, we kind of grew up in, and tell this wonderful story of these toys that everybody knows they come alive. I mean, I knew it growing up. Everybody knew it growing up is that
real. People believe it. That's better.
We did it! We did it! Yes!
More important than the Space Ranger look is the Space Ranger attitude.
Eat laser, Zerg.
Now that's the right stuff.
Has anyone told them that this won't work?
I just don't have the heart. They'll never make hyperspeed with that much weight.
Hey, buddy! Look at me! I'm a Space Ranger!
Actually, he's just a space cadet. Keeps forgetting the secret handshake.
Has anyone told them that this won't work?
I just don't have the heart. There's not nearly enough fuel to get them to their home world.
So, Mr. Lightyear, what do you think?
It takes a lot more than a goldfish bowl to be a Space Ranger, fella. Now, you're a Space Ranger. Congratulations.
Thank you. Okay, steering contest, go! Go!
There's usually a time limit for moving, but seeing as how this is a casual game between friends, I suppose International Checker Foundation rules can just be waived.
Bad move.
We're here in the story department with head of story extraordinaire, Joe Rampt. Hi, Joe. Say hi.
Hi.
Now, We're going to explain to you exactly how we just create story. We usually start with the written word, and I'll write something. And then once I think it's good enough, I ask for see if John likes it and approves it. Yeah, it's great! Approved! And he gives it to Joe, as you can see. And then what exactly do you do with it, Joe?
Well, I take the written word and I draw it into pictures. And then I take those pictures and I pin them to a board, a storyboard like this. And then after that's done, I pitch it to the directors.
Okay, now why exactly do you pitch them to the director?
Well, I want to give a sense of what this movie could be like. So it's like telling a story to your friends and try to bring it to life and get a feeling of what the story could be like on a, as a final film.
Oh, so it's what it would feel like to be in the theater watching the movie.
Trying to convey that feeling to people.
So what are we going to see now?
Right now, you're going to see me pitching the Army Man sequence from the first Toy Story. And by the way, this was the very first sequence ever storyboarded on Toy Story 1.
Yep, it was.
Okay, so this is the scene where Woody calls the army men together to go spy on what the birthday presents are downstairs.
Ooh.
All the toys are worried, so Woody goes over to the sergeant and says, "Sergeant, establish a recon post downstairs. Code red. You know what to do." Sergeant says, "Yes, sir." He hops off and he goes down by the bucket of soldiers. He goes, "You heard him. Code red. Repeat. We are at code red. Recon plan. Charlie, execute. Let's move, 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 move." And all the soldiers start jumping out of the bucket and they start marching. The other toys are watching him. And then we cut to the hallway. All is quiet. And then the door opens and one little soldier appears down by the banister. Or what do you call that? Down by the molding. Mm-hmm. And he motions down by the baseboard. And the little soldier runs across. He hops over, sees that the coast is clear, and signals. And then the troops start moving out, and they're carrying a baby monitor, and they got a coil of jump rope. And they come down the hall, and then they're over by the stairs, and they start coming out and hiding behind the columns. And Sarge holds back behind the one column, and he looks down, and all the kids are downstairs, and Mom's saying, "All right, kids, it's ready to open the presents. I'm going to go get the cake and ice cream." And they go, "Okay, Mom," and all the kids run away. And the coast is clear. And Sarge looks down, sees that there's nobody there, and then he turns over and he gets the silent hand signal. One, two, to two of these soldiers. And we zip pan over, and two paratroopers jump down, and foof, foof, their parachutes open up, and they come gliding through the scene down to the floor on the first story below. And they pull out their guns just to, you know, make sure the coast is clear and everything's safe. So they look up and they start signaling for the rest of the guys to follow. And the jump rope comes down. The guys on the bottom, I already got their parachutes put away because they're so fast. And they, And then they start speed rappelling. These guys are like a Cracker Jack Special Forces unit. They speed rappel down into the circle of safety down at the bottom of the net. And then we cut back up to the room. And then all the toys start running over to Woody. And Woody pulls out this baby monitor. And he sets it up onto the bedside stand and clicks it on and says, "Now this is how we're going to find out what's in those presents." And all the toys start crowding around. Meanwhile, the army guys are downstairs walking by the kitchen door. And they're marching. And then they hear some footsteps coming. And Sarge turns around, gives them the silent hand signal to freeze. And they go into their classic army man positions. The bazooka man down on one end, the mortar guy, the minesweeper. Everyone's just frozen.
Yeah.
Everyone's frozen in their army man positions. And then the door opens up and Mom comes out and the minesweeper gets crushed. So then she goes, "Oh, I thought I told him to put these away." She thinks that Andy just left some of his toys out. She uses her foot to kind of kick him over and they slam up against the wall. Mom continues walking past, and Woody's up there with the toys, and Rex is getting worried. "What's taking them so long?" And Woody says, "Come on, these guys are professionals. They're the best. They're not lying down on the job." And then we cut down to them all lying down. They're all lying around. Sarge looks up, and he gets to his feet and signals for them all done with silent hand signals. "Get up." And they start moving. Sarge shows them where to go, and they start moving towards the planter. And then he calls up to the other guys to send down the baby monitor, and he looks over, and the minesweeper guy's wounded. He says, Sarge, go on without me. And he picks him up, and he goes, "A good soldier never leaves a man behind." And he starts dragging him out and sending all the other guys off, the rest of the squads, bringing the baby monitor down. These guys are lowering it down. They jump off, unwind the jump rope from the baby monitor. They rush it over to the plant. They get it up into the house plant. He's dragging, you know, Sarge is dragging the wounded minesweeper guy when kids are coming. A ball starts bouncing towards him. Oh, no, it's the pressure's on. They're like, the other guys are up in the plant saying, come, you know, motion them for him to come on. And then finally, at the last second, they haul the wounded guy up into the plant, and the kids go running by. And then we pan through, like, this jungle terrain, but it's within a house plant. And they set up the baby monitor, and they click it on, and we pan down to the medic. And he's taking care of the wounded guy. He knows it's okay. He gives the thumbs up signal, and we pan over to this like moss kind of stuff. And up comes Sarge, and he goes, "Ah, oh, there they are." He gets his binoculars, and we see all the presents right there. Where they're gonna watch it open.
Now let's all be nice and say hello to our new friend.
Buzz Lightyear mission log, stardate 4072. I've landed on a strange planet.
Terrain seems a bit unstable. No readout yet as to whether the air is breathable.
My ship!
Damn. This'll take weeks to repair.
It looks as though I might be here a while.
And there seems to be no sign of intelligent life anywhere.
Hello?
Oh, yeah! I'm...
Whoa! Didn't mean to frighten you there, pal.
Howdy. Welcome to Andy's room. I'm Woody. And, well, this is a bit awkward, but you see, there's been a bit of a mistake. This bed is my spot.
Local and, law enforcement. It's about time you got here. I'm Buzz Lightyear, Space Ranger, Universe Protection Unit. All right, fill me in here. Where's the danger?
Danger?
I must have been sent to this planet because of some danger or catastrophe. Catastrophes are my forte.
Well, we're fresh out of catastrophes. But, you know, the closet is a mess.
Now, about the bed.
Watch yourself. Halt! Who goes there?
Don't shoot! It's okay. Friends.
Do you know these life forms?
Yes. They're Andy's toys.
All right, everyone. You're clear to come up.
They must have handled this guy awfully rough in shipping.
I am Buzz Lightyear. I come in peace.
Oh, I'm so glad you're not a dinosaur.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Now, thank you all for your kind welcome.
Say, what's that button do?
I'll show you. Buzz Lightyear to the rescue.
Wow. Hey, well, Woody's got something like that. His is a pull string, only...
Only it sounds like a car ran over it.
Oh, yeah, not like this one. This is a quality sound system. Probably all copper wiring, huh? So, where are you from? Singapore? Hong Kong?
I'm stationed in the Gamma Quadrant of Sector 4.
Oh, really? I'm from Play School.
And I'm from Mattel. Well, I'm not really from Mattel. I'm actually from a smaller company that was purchased in a leveraged buyout. Well, I don't really understand the financials.
I'll bet he glows in the dark. Excuse me, handsome, but what would happen if I push that big button of yours?
Please, be careful.
You don't want to be in the way when my laser goes off.
Don't I?
Hey, a laser! How come you don't have a laser, Woody?
It's not a laser. It's a little light bulb that blinks.
What's with him?
Laser envy.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y. Toy.
Excuse me. I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
The word I'm searching for, I can't say because there's preschool toys present.
Getting kind of tense, aren't you?
Oh, Mr. Lightyear, now I'm curious. What does a space ranger actually do?
He's not a space ranger. He doesn't fight evil or shoot lasers or fly.
Excuse me.
Oh, impressive wingspan. Very good.
Oh, what? What? These are plastic. He can't fly.
They are a pterillium carbonic alloy, and I can fly.
No, you can't.
Yes. I can't.
You can't.
Can.
Hey, this is getting good.
And I tell you, I can fly around this room with my eyes closed.
Okay, then, Mr. Lightbeer, prove it.
All right, then I will. Stand back, everyone.
You guys better get ready to clean up the wreckage.
To infinity and beyond!
And when they found him, his batteries were dead.
What are you afraid of? You don't even use batteries.
Oh, right.
And the scariest part was, when the leveraged buyout fell through, the toy company was left with a big dark warehouse full of inventory.
Oh, if I had bones, they'd be chilling. And the toy made it all the way from the clearance aisle to the cashier. The last words he heard were, "How did that get in the cart?" True story.
Help! I can't sleep.
Try counting sheep.
One, two, three. I don't see how this will help.
This is where we're going to explain the animation process of how we make films here at Pixar. This is a scene from Toy Story 1. This is when Buzz and Woody first meet. Now, the first stage is the storyboard stage, and you'll see the drawings, still drawings done for the scene. It's kind of like a comic book version.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y. Toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
This next step is the layout phase of production. Once the storyboards and the models are ready, they come into layout. This is where we first build the film on the computer, our first step into 3D. There's no performance yet. That's what the animators do. Here we concern ourselves with the basic composition and blocking of the film.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y. Toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
The next step in the process is animation. And this is where the animators take the story ideas and the layout and really bring the characters to life. And this is where they take good story ideas and truly make them great with their really amazing performances.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y. Toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
This is the final stage in the production. This is when we've taken the animation and we've added the shading and the lights to it. And this is where everything comes together and we get the final images.
All right.
What we're about to look at is the chase sequence from the first Toy Story. Now, this section, we get to see it three different ways.
First, you get to see the storyboard version.
How many? That was drawn out. It was a long one.
It was one of the longest sequences we ever boarded for the film. It was like 10 big boards long. But it worked. It worked great. And then the second level you're going to see is
the layout section. And this is where you'll see all the camera work. There's no animation in it yet. The characters are just kind of stiff, you know. But we plan out the whole action that way.
But you'll see it in the computer there. And then the third level will be the final version. Sort of the cool thing about this is that you're going to be able to go through all those while you're simultaneously watching it in real time. Right. So what you need to do is you need to get your DVD remote, okay? Then you need to find out where your angle button is,
Right there.
Okay, and then you're gonna ride, baby. You're gonna ride. Okay?
Woo!
Playing it, you're just gonna keep clicking it, going from story to layout to like final to layout to story, back to final, whenever you want to. It's so cool!
Layout is the basic filmmaking part of the process. We build the foundation of the film. We take the models and the storyboards, and we construct each shot. We grab the sets, the characters, the cameras, put everything together, get it ready for animation. In this process, we face a lot of problems. So problem solving is a big part of our day, and I'd like to show you some of the tricks we used to solve problems we found on Toy Story. There's a right and a wrong way to compose over-the-shoulder shots. This is a typical movie situation. You put an imaginary line between the heads of the two characters and make sure the camera doesn't cross that line. It sometimes gets called the stage line, sometimes the line of action. If the camera crosses the line, notice how Woody is suddenly replaced by Buzz. Just as in live-action filmmaking, keeping the camera on the correct side of the line makes sure that, well, in this case, Woody stays on the right and Buzz stays on the left, and the audience doesn't get lost as they paced along in a two-shot. So we called this trenching. We would bury Woody 2 or 3 centimeters into the ground to get his face down closer to Buzz. And in this view, in this sequence, we had a little bit of a problem. This is where Buzz has just gone out the window and the toys are really upset. The storyboards were drawn as though Andy's desk were the size of a soccer field. And in fact, we did cheat up the size of the desk for this sequence. But it was so tricky to figure out, we ended up standing up with each other in the screening room doing practically a square dance, figuring out how we were going to block it out. We also had an interesting requirement. Our normal stage line in this movie had Sid's house on the left, Andy's house on the right, and we had moved that line around. We needed to get it back where it belonged before Andy came through the door. So that big whirling camera move around Woody while he's being attacked with the army men was just to put the stage line back where it belonged.
Okay, Mom, be right down. I've got to get Buzz.
Believe it or not, we are in the animation pit here at Pixar Animation Studios. And this is where all the animation that you see in the films is created. If you look around, you'll see the animators take their cubicles and they decorate them in really cool ways. But in the end, it all comes down to this. This is an animator's workstation, and these are the tools of his trade. Now, at this point, we're going to take you through a progression reel that shows you specifically how the animation is created. The first step is layout, where we block the action of the scene. Sometimes an animator will shoot some live-action reference to help him create the performance. Now the animator starts to work out the rough body gestures.
Nothing. I'm sure Andy was just a little excited. That's all. Too much cake and ice cream, I suppose. It's just a mistake.
Now the animator continues to refine his overall performance.
Nothing. I'm sure Andy was just a little excited. That's all. Too much cake and ice cream, I suppose. It's just a mistake.
We always feel that if the pantomime performance is working, then the facial animation is the icing on the cake.
Nothing. I'm sure Andy was just a little excited. That's all. Too much cake and ice cream, I suppose. It's just a mistake.
And finally, after weeks of work, the final shot.
Am I too tall for this? Be honest.
Woo!
Hey, fellas, which one of you was saving my place in line? Is this line for ticket holders or is it for ticket buyers? So, what are we waiting for?
Toy Story was a really fun film to do sound for. We would play with the material as much as we could and try to have fun with it as well. It was considered very important to make each character as unique as possible with the sound so that you can identify it with sound only if need be, and it would stand out from the other characters. Buzz Lightyear was a fun toy to do because we had to do a couple of things. He had to sound like a toy, and then it would have to sound kind of cheap. We made a special point with the sound effects on the TV commercial to make them even more unbelievable. We thought that that would be fun since that, of course, is the way it happens in real life. TV commercials are just one step beyond reality. Thank you. And for the scene where he jumps off the bedposts and attempts to fly, the shots that are from his POV are huge in the sound. When he flies up into the air and down from the plane onto the bed, even though he's not really flying, you put these very rocket-like whooshes in to make him seem a little bit more superheroic. Of course, the biggest moment from these little toys' point of view is when the semi-truck drives over Woody and Buzz in the Dinoco station. The sounds could get huge. Scud is a dog, and most of the time his sounds are a dog. A lot of times they're my dog, Buster. Sleeping sounds, the snoring, the growling while he was asleep, and the growling that Scud makes as he starts to stalk Woody and Buzz through the hallway are not dog sounds at all, but tigers and elephants and lions and big sounds. To get cartoony in the old-fashioned sense with a lot of boinks and twangs, unless they were called for. There were places where a funny over-the-top boiling sound when Woody puts his burning head into the cereal bowl. Most of the time, the sounds were based on realistic sounds and then exaggerated to be funny, like a toolbox crash. Although a couple times we would take liberties. We used a plunger sound again, but in a different context. My favorite exaggerated sound effect in the movie, though, is when Woody runs in the cup. We have a little straw squeak. And so I did that in rhythm to Woody's run, and it made me laugh.
We are at the final mix. We're about 2 weeks away from the complete finish of production. And this is where we take all of the sound, the music Randy Newman has done, the sound effects Gary Reitzram has done, and all the dialogue. We balance it so we get the right blend of it all.
Well, howdy-ho, a Western.
Oh.
Fine, then you pick the show.
Excellent, the Star Eaters.
Oh, please, not science fiction.
Fiction?
Hey, a dinosaur documentary. Maybe this one has a happy ending.
And there's the media. My turn.
Wall Street Report?
Oh, sure, on the outside I might be a pig, but on the inside, I'm all bank.
Okay, more to the left. Now grab his leg. No, his other leg. No, his other leg. Good.
Why doesn't Andy just get cable?
Anybody mind if I change?
Go!
No, do not anger the TV.
The tube speaks to us. That Urkel slays me.
Hey, know what I'm doing?
Yeah, breaking the TV remote.
No, I'm channel surfing! Get it? Channel surfing!
To infinity and beyond!
Blast!
A force field.
It's glass, Buzz.
This force field is unusually firm. Must find a way.
Glass, Buzz, not a force field. It's a television. You watch cartoons on it. Unless you break it with your big, thick helmet head!
Stay back, friend. They've gotten to you, haven't they?
Go!
Oh!
lying across the sky. Where there's injustice, you'll find him. Wherever a wrong to right, Buzz Lightyear will join the fight. Buzz Lightyear, Buzz Lightyear, Buzz Lightyear. Buzz Lightyear. Somewhere beyond the stars, a thousand light years distant, is there my heart may wander no more. Three little words and all was gone. These bitter words. Like a million of my my kind. Just a toy for children to play with. Where will I find the strength to go on? To face another dawn. But no, it can't be true. I am deceived by my enemies, of whom there are more than a few. And if I believe, if I really believe I can fly, then I'll fly. Of the world living high, it was right in my pocket. I was living the life, things were just the way they should be. But from out of the sky, like a bomb, comes some little punk in a rocket. Now, all of a sudden, some strange things are happening to me. Someone you think you know well, and it turns out a stranger. The minute you turn your back, you're in it all by yourself. They laugh at your jokes, you think you're doing quite well, but you're in danger, boy. You end up alone and forgotten, way up on the shelf.
Anymore.
They do anything for me.
Whoa.
I had it all. I was loved.
He was loved.
No, I was worshipped. But I threw it away. And the one I really care for, he no longer cares for me.
How blind the fool can be.
The road gets rougher. Further you go, seem like life gets a little bit tougher. They have done to me. Nah.
Do you know that as we calmly sit here, an intense debate rages within the paleontological community? Were dinosaurs hot-blooded or were they cold-blooded? I'm overwrought with anxiety over this issue. I mean, what temperature was their blood? There's even a third camp that theorizes that larger dinosaurs may have been born hot-blooded, and after growing to a sufficient size, they suddenly switched to cold-blooded. Who am I supposed to believe? And so the Jurassic gave way to the Cretaceous. For 72 million years, dinosaurs ruled the Earth.
And then?
Kaboom!
This is John Culhane. We're in for a special treat today. We've arranged to go live via satellite to the stars of Toy Story, Woody and Buzz. Hello, guys.
Hello.
Hello.
Where are you guys exactly?
This is a set for Andy's room. It's where all us toys live in the movie.
It is? You told me it was my dressing room.
Tell us how it all started.
Well, first it was a swirling mass of hydrogen gas in space. As it
cooled... He's talking about the film, Buzz.
Oh, that.
You see, the film is about life, as seen from a toy's perspective.
Can you tell us about your respective parts in the film?
Sure. I play Andy's favorite toy.
No. I play Andy's favorite toy.
Buzz, you're wrong.
I believe it is implied to the audience that I hold Andy's favorite from my first close-up.
Wrong. It must hurt to be so wrong.
So, it's a buddy picture?
Yes.
I understand you do your own stunts. It looks awful dangerous.
It's all done with computers now. I don't even understand it myself. In fact, I...
Hello. My agent. I have to take this.
Yeah. Well, we're running out of time. Thanks a lot for talking to us. Best of luck.
Thank you.
No, gross. Not net.
Sergeant?
Yes, sir.
Establish your recon post downstairs.
Code Red, repeat. We are at Code Red. Recon plan, Charlie. Execute. Move. It's a
big one.
Walt Disney Pictures presents a totally new animated motion picture event.
Star Command, come in. Do you read me?
The story of two toys.
There seems to be no sign of intelligent life anywhere.
Hello?
Oh, yeah! Ah!
Headed for a showdown.
My name is Woody. This is my spot.
Ah!
I am Buzz Lightyear. I come in peace.
You are a child's plaything!
You are a sad, strange little man.
And playing by their own rules.
Draw!
Got me again!
I don't like confrontations!
Buzz, look, an alien!
Where?
Ah!
You're mocking me, aren't you?
Oh, impressive wingspan. Very good.
Oh, what? What? He can't fly?
Yes, I can.
Can't!
This holiday season, the adventure takes off when toys come to life.
To infinity
and beyond!
Toy Story.
Look out!
Can.
For anyone who's ever wondered what toys do when people aren't around.
Hey, everybody, it's showtime.
Walt Disney Pictures invites you into a world where toys come to life.
Wow, cool!
Let's go to my room, guys!
Red alert! Andy is coming upstairs! Andy's coming, everybody! Back to your places, hurry!
Did you see my ear?
Out of my way!
Woody, the veteran.
Draw! No! Got me again!
Buzz, the rookie.
Have you been replaced?
No one's getting replaced.
Excuse me.
Buzz Lightyear to the rescue!
Oh, okay. Who else?
You're mocking me, aren't you?
Ow!
What do you say I get someone else to watch the sheep tonight?
Hell yeah!
Don't even think about it, cowboy.
Two heroes, ready for anything.
I don't like confrontations!
Except each other.
Whoa!
Hey, a laser!
It's not a laser. It's a little light bulb that blinks.
What's with him?
Laser envy. Guys, come on.
But that's about to change. They've stepped over the edge.
Buzz!
And into the real world.
I think he bounced into Sid's yard. He tortures toys.
Where is your honor, dirtbag?
A good soldier never leaves a man behind.
Where the name of the game is survival.
I'm lost.
So it's all your fault.
My fault?
I've set my laser
to kill.
You're a toy. Use your karate chop action.
Stop that.
What's going on down there?
Come in, Star Command. Send reinforcements.
You are a toy.
You are a sad, strange little man.
Where's that wimpy cowboy dog?
All right, man.
Move.
There's no place like home. Come on, this way.
Negative. Ah. We'll be much safer in the cockpit.
What an idiot.
Great idea, Woody. Go infinity and beyond.
Walt Disney Pictures presents the first ever computer animated motion picture.
We've got trouble.
This holiday season, take off on an adventure.
This cannot be happening to me.
Beyond imagination.
Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
This is the perfect time to panic.
It's the story of two partners discovering what they're made of.
I'm okay. Catch that! I got it, Woody.
Next stop, Andy.
Go to infinity and beyond!
Toy Story.
Look out! Buzz, will you get up here and give me a hand?
That's very funny, Buzz.
This is serious!
Okay, everybody, coast is clear.
This holiday season,
it's showtime.
Turn on your imagination.
That's using the old noodle.
When toys come to life.
Boo!
Walt Disney Pictures presents the first ever computer animated feature film.
Code Red, we are Code Red.
Go infinity. Boom! And beyond.
Toy Story, rated G. In a world where toys come to life, they're two heroes.
Hell yeah.
Two rivals.
Don't even think about it, cowboy.
I don't like confrontations.
Too close to the edge.
Whoa.
I got dibs on his hand.
Now, to make it back home, they'll have to become two partners.
This is no time to panic.
This is the perfect time to panic. Buzz, will you get up here and give me a hand?
Toy Story, rated G. Walt Disney Pictures presents...
Straw! Stone! Got me again!
A world where toys come to life. Woody, the lawman.
Hello?
Buzz, the spaceman.
Space Ranger.
Okay, ooh,
You're mocking me.
Two heroes on an adventure big enough for both of them.
Hey, a laser!
It's a little light bulb that blinks.
What's with him?
Laser envy.
Toy Story.
I've set my laser to kill.
Right, we can blink him to death.
Rated G.
We are Code Red.
Andy is coming upstairs.
For anyone who ever wondered...
Everybody, back to your places, hurry!
Miss my ear!
Let's move!
Why their toys were never where they left them.
Their toys are alive!
They're cannibals.
The first computer animated motion picture...
Whoa!
...is here.
Look, I'm Picasso!
Toy Story.
I don't get it.
Rated G.
Thank you.
When did it get here?
Right after lunch.
Scanner readings are inconclusive.
Maybe Andy got peanut butter on your scanner.
There's only one way to find out what's in there.
I'll handle this. Oh, it's a happy snacky. Oh, no.
I come in peace.
Evil Emperor Zurg did this.
Actually, hey, Buzzy, I think it was one of your major fast food chains.
So they just give you away with a burger and fries.
I came with chicken fingers.
Is this good for the economy?
We're doomed! Who's gonna buy what they can get for free?
So, what can you do there, little mister?
Well, if you pivot my head, my arm kind of makes this punching move.
Wow, I'm just a collectible.
And that's it?
Pretty much.
I think we're safe, guys.
Is it me, or do you smell cheeseburgers?
A stranger from the outside. The claw is our master. The claw chooses who will go and who will stay. But you hold the remote of destiny. Ask the claw to move left or right. And press the circle button to beseech the claw to bring us to a better place. The claw will choose. We are eternally grateful. Ask the claw to move left or right to begin. The claw, it does not choose. You must learn the ways of the claw. Our friend, the Vegetable Man. We are eternally grateful.
Meet Mr. Potato Head, the starchy dude with attitude, the spud of a thousand faces. Watch this versatile vegetable transform before your very eyes. Silly, sad, angry, or glad, no matter how you slice it, this spunky spud is tons of fun.
And this is the toy box. Well, that concludes your new toy orientation. Don't worry, little partner. I'm sure you'll fit in.
Yes! Look! Ooh, ball! Ooh, ball!
See? It's easy. Just takes a little practice.
Ooh!
That's good. That's a good start. I know. It's not funny when clowns do it either. Hey, where's my hat? My badge.
Howdy. Howdy.
Give me that. Clear.
Good play day, everybody.
So, how was your day, Buzz?
If you don't mind, I'd rather not talk about it.